could say check all the winners that do not include array.
Yeah, that's great.
Well, I claim that you should always do this. But I think this
test.
Matt, ready?
To set up everything?
Yeah, I think so.
I forgot what I was supposed to say.
What?
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Is it? It is time.
It's time, I believe, yes.
It's time?
Yeah.
Hello? We'll start a new presentation and we continue a little bit in the same area of technology. Jeffrey Carter will explain how to use Ada for user interface, but built also around web technology. Can okay, Jeffrey.
All right, hello. I'm Jeffrey Carter. A few years ago, David Botten, created a thing called Gnoga, which uses aspects of HTML5 to use a browser as a GUI, and also allows you to develop web applications. It's all in Ada. And unlike other presentations you've seen so far today, I don't have a presentation. I just have programs and code. I should probably have already done that, shouldn't I? Hold on a second. Where'd that go? Oh, there it is.
To a larger fund?
A what?
A larger fund in your terminal, just...
In my terminal?
Oh, well, if you think you're editor, then...
You can't read that? What's the matter?
No.
Can...
it's... Control plus, I think, works.
Is that the one? I see. In GPS? No, it doesn't.
Try in the edit menu and
text size, yes. Now you have text size in the edit menu.
Do I have it in the edit menu?
In the edit menu.
Ah, okay. Ah, there it is. Increase, and it says control plus. Okay, well, I guess I was using the wrong plus. Big enough?
One more?
One more time.
I'm in the back.
More?
Larger.
We're good? Okay. I can probably do something similar here with, this, if I can remember how that is done. Zoom, yes. Maybe that'll help. Okay, so I started playing with Gnoga and wrote some programs which ended up being incorporated in the set of demos that come with Gnoga. And I mentioned to Dirk that I had done this, and he thought it would be good for me to show you how it works. I'm not really familiar with the underlying implementation. This is just how to use it. The first thing I'll show you is how to create it, use it as a, to use your browser as a GUI. What is referred to in Gnoga as a singleton application. So this is possibly the simplest program ever. It looks like this. And it basically lets you put in some numbers. And it will pseudo-randomly pick a number in that range. Okay, where did the GPS go? There it is. So the organization of a typical Gnoga application is, for me, under an empty package spec. You want a package because Gnoga uses named access to subprogram types, and therefore you have to have subprograms that are declared in a library level package to pass the accessibility rules. So that's that. Your actual program looks sort of like this. Because what you're going to do is put everything in your UI package, which is here. So you have to declare some things from the Gnoga GUI hierarchy of packages. Everything has a window. You usually need a view to put things in. And certain things, like these number types and the text type where the result comes out, are part of what is called forms. And we'll talk about that a little more later. So I've got two things for entering numbers. That's the min and max. The two labels that go on those to say minimum and maximum. The button to generate the result, a place to show the result, and the quit button. Then I got this form because these things are part of the form thing. And in the elaboration of the package, you create your GUI. It's very similar to other GUI frameworks. You create things. This right here will open your default browser. This puts a title on it. This shows you something to display when you end. So your browser tab or window stays there, and it just has this message displayed. And this initializes a singleton application in your window. Then you can create your things, your views. Now, I've set the width of the view short so that it doesn't put everything on the far right side because of this thing, which is the form, which I create inside that view. And this is the text alignment, which lies. It's not actually text alignment, it's everything alignment. And I set the alignment of everything in this form to be on the right. Then I create the entry. And I have a placeholder, which is what it displays initially. Enter an integer. And I create the label for it. And it says minimum value. Similarly, for the entry for the maximum value, the result, the generate button, I connect the generate button on using its access. This is where you register a callback. This is called onSubmit handler because it's for the form. And this is a submit button for the form. That's part of the form handling that we'll get into later. Finally, the quit button, And it's on click handler. When you click on it, it will call on quit, because I registered on quit with it here. And then you give up this thread of control to the message loop, which is really not necessary in Ada because it can have its own task. And in fact, inside Gnoga, as I understand it, every time you do an action and it gets sent to your program from the browser, Gnoga creates a task to handle that event. So this is the thing. The onQuit simply ends the application, which causes this to return. And then the fun part is this onGenerate. I get the two values. I don't have to do any validation on those because they are number types and so will contain an integer. In fact, this value returns an integer. I've done a little bit here to swap the values if you put them in the wrong order. It'll swap them for you. And then I redisplay them in case I swapped them. I instantiate the discrete random number generator for a subtype with that range, generate a value, and stick it in the result. That's the whole thing. Now, the thing with a form is that this forms are not really needed with Gnoga. You can handle a button click, go and access the values of the fields. But they do allow certain automated tests. If I submit it and it doesn't have a number in it, I get this message. If I submit it and I haven't put anything in it, I get a message. Things like that. And that second message saying that it needs a value is because I've said it's required. The first message saying enter an integer is because it's a number type. That's about it. Let's see. There's this fun thing when you create stuff, is that things are put one after another horizontally, and you use this new line. This is one way to get down and put things underneath. So I got my view here, which is 500 wide. Inside the view, I've got the form input. And the stuff inside the form is right justified. So this is 500 wide here. And this shows the right edge of that view is here. Clear? Amazing. Okay. Now we'll go over to something a little more complicated. Which is this guy here. Let me see if I can do this. So this is a web application. I realized when I started playing with this that you have this one thing that runs, and it has this mode called a multi-connect program as opposed to the singleton, which I just created, or which we just discussed in the random integers. This one, you can hook up to it from multiple places. So if I can find my pointer again, there it is. If I open a different browser, I did. So now I got both browsers connected up to the same program. And if this program were running on a computer that you could access over the internet, you could just put in the URL for it with the appropriate port number and connect to it over the internet. No change to the program. If we look at the log here, when I connected from Firefox, we got this connection. Connected from Chromium, I got this one. And what this does, you put in an email address, and I use an email address simply as a unique identifier. And this is actually pretty simple. It just has to look like an email address. It doesn't have to actually be an address. So it then brings me up, and if I have a friend that I want to talk to, then I can add that guy in. Now he's not online because he doesn't have an asterisk, so we can't talk to him yet. If I go back in here, now it's discovered that A at B.C. was already online and already added me as a friend, and so it's put him in as one of my friends. Let me see something here. You may not be able to hear this, but just in case. So if I go in here, I can say, and you'll see back here that the program sent that information to this other person that I'm friends with and displayed it on his screen. Okay, there's actually a ding sound that it plays when you get a message, but we're not getting any sound out of this right now. So that is that, and how it works, or is supposed to work. Boom. If we go in to somewhere, is it under source? Under demo. And we have this giant text. And because this is a multiple connect, we need to have a connection data type. And all those fields that in the singleton were just in the package are in this record. So we've got here two basic screens, the one where you enter the email address and connect, and the one where you are chatting. And so we've got fields for both of those. And Gnoga deals with this application data through pointers. As you'll see later, when we get an event, we get one of these pointers with it, or we can get one of these pointers from it. And, well, I'm not a real fan of visible access types. Gnoga somehow keeps track of them and gets rid of them when they're no longer being used, which is a good thing. Okay, so that's the root package. And the program package is very familiar.
I have a question here.
Yes?
This program exists. I mean, is it some placeholder where you can add some processing if you want to? Or why is it there? Why is the empty procedure?
Why does the program exist? Why does this file exist, is what you're asking?
Why does the procedure exist?
Why does the procedure exist? Because it's the main program procedure for this application.
So, when you call this creates the elaboration, or runs the elaboration?
This elaborates the UI package, which runs the program. Just as.
Is it possible for you to add some code in here that would inform something?
Probably. I don't know when it would run because the elaboration of this gives up the thread of control, which is the environment task, to Gnoga. And so anything you put in here would run when that returned, which is when the program ends. And this kind of program never ends. If we go back here, you'll see that when you start it up, it says, press Control C to close the server. That's the only way you end this program. Okay. Unlike the random integer, which is such a simple program that I put all the logic in the UI package, this is somewhat more complex. And I have a DB package, which keeps track of who's connected and who their friends are. So I got this set. Which due to my use of long lines is scrolled way off the screen for unbounded string. And what I've got is user data that consists of a contact and one of the pointers to the app data. So once I find a user and I get his user data, I have a pointer to his window data, which I can then use to update his window. And then I got add a user with this app data to the DB, check if a user exists, remove a user from the DB, send message from user from to all of his contacts. make friend one of user's friends and make friend no longer one of user's friends. Pretty straightforward. We won't go into the internals of this package. You can find it online and look at it yourself if you have that much interest. So then the fun part is the UI. Now there's two versions here. One allows it to run securely and one doesn't. Used to be only needed one, but I made some changes to Gnoga and so now they're different. So we'll just look at this one. And the elaboration part of this looks a little bit different because it simply sets up this and it connects here the onConnect handler. This is not related to the connect button. This is when somebody puts the URL for this thing in their browser. It causes this connect event and this onConnect procedure will be called. And then again, it gives up the thread of control to Gnoga. So, the important part of this is the onConnect. Which sets up the main window with this new app info pointer as its data and creates the email screen, holds the connection, which means that the connection will remain continued until the server deletes it or the browser is closed, and make sure that this this here should do nothing. I don't remember why it's in here. Oh well. Okay. And create email screen sets up the window and is very similar to the elaboration part of the singleton app, random integers that we looked at, creating buttons and things. But instead of doing it as that did to global variables, this does it to variables in the app record because it'll be called for different users, different connections. When the user clicks connect, having entered his email, then we create his chat screen and add him to the DB. And the chat screen has got a lot more to it than the connection screen, the email screen, but it's basically the same thing. Now I used what is called a doc because at the time I wrote this, this was the only thing that let you put things on different parts of the screen. So I got the chat, which is a view, is connected to the left side of the dock, and the friends, which is another view or maybe a form, is connected to the right side of the dock. Since then, there's been added a thing called a grid, which will divide your window up into pieces, and then you can put things in individual pieces. Gives you greater control over the layout, and had it existed, I probably would have used it at that time. And so then the fun thing is, when you've typed in a message and you've pressed send, it gets the message that you typed. then calls the db.send, which looks at all your friends and sends them that message. And then it calls its own show message procedure to display it to yourself, the person who typed it in. And you'll notice that ding is false. When you press send, you don't hear the ding. But if we can find show, here we go. So this adds your message to the end of the existing message in that chat screen, separated by a line feed character and preceded by the email address of the person who sent it. And scrolls to make sure that it's on the screen. And then if ding is true, it's got a little multimedia thing in there to play audio, and it plays it. But we aren't hearing that, unfortunately. And you can see the send in the DB okay. Because Gnoga creates tasks, I've put all the real operations in here, because especially with multiple people connected and working at the same time, calls might come in at the same time to this database and they need to be sequentialized. And so it iterates over the contact set and passes each contact to this thing, which then calls the show in the UI. So that's an example of using this app data pointer that we stored in the DB to call back to the UI. And if I'm lucky, we might be able this isn't always running. This is the Gnoga.com website. So this is not running over the web. This is not always available. And the other thing, of course, is that the certificate on this site is expired. This is secure, but you have to make an exception for the certificate. The only reason that we're using the certificate is to encrypt the data that we're sending between the browser and the site. And so an expired certificate should serve for that purpose, as well as one that hasn't expired. So this is actually running over the web if you are interested in messing with it that way. All right, I guess we have a few minutes left. Is that correct? Is that clear? 15 minutes left. Oh my God. Yes?
How about CSS? Still shits because it looks like a real application. from the beginning of the web.
Well, I'm not claiming to be a great UI designer. I just threw these things together quickly to try out and to demonstrate that this kind of stuff could be done. If you get a decent UI designer, I'm sure it will look a lot better. But
it looks like a bit like an IBM green screen from the 60s.
Could be, yes.
But you can attach style sheets.
Yeah, on the components, class and so on. Each component, and then the statue.
Yes.
I don't know anything about using CSS with Gnoga. Technically, you can put stuff in HTML and connect your application to it.
Well, which, no problem with you.
Pardon?
I did it quite often.
Yeah.
No problem.
I think and the HTML elements, they have their IDs automatically generated by Gnoga.
Yes.
But you can set them yourself to whatever you want. So by knowing their IDs, you can use them in your CSS.
Actually, Gnoga is a communication protocol. The low-level stuff is JavaScript. What's called the
WebSockets.
It's WebSockets.
WebSockets and HTML for the rendering.
Mm-hmm.
And you have low-level access also to the HTML part. So if you don't have a predefined stuff, or if you want to build your own widgets, then you may access the HTML level and whatever you want at the HTML level.
It has vector graphic support.
It's also possible to change the way things look through the Gnoga interface. You can change colors, typefaces, stuff like that. I had one where I wanted the output to be in a monospaced font, so I was able to do that. Yes?
I think I remember there was a Minesweeper game with you at Gnoga.
Yes.
Graphical.
That is really not very graphical, but...
Oh, you could show the pasta.
Or pasta, yes.
Pasta.
Pasta is graphical. Do you remember where that one is?
Pasta.pirana.com. Yeah, I'm not using it every day.
How is this?
Pyrama.com.
Pirama. Okay. Let's see what we get.
Did you get it wrong?
No, I got no script and it's blocking it. There it is.
And
this one might look better than mine.
One nice feature with this one is actually it also on touch devices. It works with swipe as well as ordinary drag and drop of the mouse.
Uh-huh. So it can work with a touch screen.
Yes.
Yes. So that's another example of what you can do. Yes?
Hi. Just wondering, how many users can connect to this application together before it starts to grow?
I don't know.
I would say I've done some testing with the back end, and we found a bug in Apache Bench. It can't count properly when you're running more than a million requests per second. Of course, when you put real application code behind, you'll slow a bit down compared to that. But the raw framework, you go beyond a million requests per second. So it's okay.
You probably run out of memory in the database before. you get anywhere close to a million users.
But still, the thing is with Gnoga, I don't think it's perfect for these users that have a bad connection to the internet. Because when the connection is severed, for me the default
yes.
behavior is the screen is cleaned out. You see nothing. And so to use Gnoga, your users, they should have a very good internet access. And I don't think it's optimal for the internet, although it's been used for that.
Yeah.
You can do it. But I think it's optimal for in-house applications for companies, mm-hmm. because then you know that all your users, they really have a good long, no problem. Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, if there are no more questions, I guess we'll take a break. Disconnect. Control C.
Years ago, David Bolton wanted to come over.
Yeah.
He realized it was on a Saturday.
It's on a Saturday, though, and he's rather orthodox, yes. When I worked with him, he always disappeared on a Friday afternoon, you know. Okay, so.
It's the first time.
Let me go down here. Grab this.
You mentioned the grid versus the dock, but I think in the end you should be able to put all your elements where you want them to be. So although this kind of automatic position mm-hmm. is quite...
You can, nice, yeah, I believe there's...
But sometimes you're not happy with the decision.
Yeah. I've only used the automatic positioning mm-hmm. of Gnoga, but there are things if you get into the lower level that let you be more specific.
Do you happen to know LaTeX?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
What do you mean is it type setting? The same principle.
Yeah.
Sometimes, or normally, you like the system to automatically put the things in. But you are also able to say, to specify exactly where each element should go.
Right.
The one from Gnoga open question is security. Because all the data that is sent to the browser,
right.
So there's JavaScript.
And, is it?
Uh-huh. Yeah. The data comes in maybe as an array of characters called eval.
Yeah.
Eval on that data.
So you've been looking at the internals.
Yeah, you don't look at the internals. Or there's no authentication. Like, did it really come from where, you know,
uh-huh.
did it come from the server or not? You know?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Although the communication can be, you know, encrypted in these things, but the, well, is it enough? You know, like.
Well, I'm not trying to do anything secure, although I did write a password generator program. But if you ran that over the web, you would want to be sure, you know, the master password, at least, that is being supplied to the program would be encrypted.
Yes.
Okay. What is that doing over there?
Ja, ik had dat bijgelegd, niet voor, voor consulteren, omdat ik ze niet helemaal direct op de 5 minuten wil wassen. Maar neem maar in mee. Dus, het is een oude, het zijn wel oude. Hè.
Ja, maar het is, een,
het is gewoon als voorbeeld.
Sorry, ik heb dat vroeger nog niet.
Just this, right? Change. Thank you.